Let's start with Schnorr signatures before we go to MUSIC and adapter signatures and what it has to do with Lightning. So let FP be a prime field of order P. Whoa, 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 don't get lost if you don't know what a prime field of order P is. I mentioned this for the tech guys and the mathematicians in here because it's the correct term. If you're not one of those, you can think of this very easily. Just think of regular numbers, regular positive integers. And there's one speciality with them. When you add two numbers from this prime field and the result is bigger than the prime number, what you do is you take the result, divide it by the prime number, and you take the remainder, the stuff that is left over. Let's do a quick example. If you have the prime number 7 and you have the two elements 5 and 6, usually if you add 5 plus 6, the result would be 11. Now 11 is bigger than 7. 7 was our prime number. So you take 11 and divide it by 7, which is 1, and there's 4 remaining. Now you say the result is 4. 5 plus 6 in this prime field would be 4. If you want to add 2 plus 3, then it's just 5, as you know it before, because 5 is smaller than 7. Next, we're going to use an elliptic curve, which is just a cyclic group of prime order P, the stuff that you regularly know from Bitcoin. And we have one last mathematical thing we need, which is a mapping from our prime field to the elliptic curve. And when we take a scalar from the prime field, we multiply it with a generator point from the elliptic curve. And that's what we're using all the time. Just a little bit of notation. The elements in the prime field are scalars, as I just mentioned, and we call them private keys. And the elements in the elliptic curve are points, or we call them public keys. You can think of them actually as Bitcoin addresses, though then they are hashed again. So let us select X as a private key and P as the corresponding public key. What this means is that we can get the public key P by multiplying our private key with the generator point, which is just according to the mapping that we defined. And this is what we call a key pair, and it's important to note that we can always get from the private key to the public key, but not the other way around. We can already define our Schnorr signature as S equals K plus H times X, where K is a random value from our prime field and H is a hash function. For the sake of simplicity, I actually omit to tell you what exactly we're hashing. If you really want to know the details, I refer you to the MUSIC paper. The MUSIC paper explains you how to prevent rogue attacks by hashing the right values, not only the Bitcoin transaction, but also committing to the public keys and maybe to the nonces. So you should really read that paper if you want to know all the details. Here we will just assume that we're hashing the correct values. As you hopefully remembered, there's one special thing about these elements in this prime field. If we add them and the value is too big, we have to take the remainder after division with this prime number, and this is what we usually note with this percent %p. In the future, I will omit this. Besides our signature equation, we also need the r value or nonce, which is the random k value times g. Our pair s, r is called our signature for our public key p. Now we can verify this signature, and what we do is we apply our function f to the signature equation, and since f is a homeomorphism, we can just apply f to the single parts of the equation, which means s times g has to be the same as r plus h times p. S and r are the signature values, so they're publicly known. The public key is obviously public known, and g was fixed, and h is known, as we can compute the hash of the message. And by the way, when we write h times p, it means p plus p plus p, h many times. In the unlikely case that you don't know why I'm talking about digital signatures and what that has to do with Bitcoin, just check out this video where I explain that Bitcoin is actually a chain of digital signatures. So if you look at this notebook, I start by importing the random package, because later on I will need random numbers. Then I define p as 23. I already define my mapping. This is in our video what was called f, or multiplying with a generator point, which goes from scalars to points. For me, points will be just letters. So basically 0 is going to be mapped to a, and b is mapped to 1, and so on and so forth. Now I'm selecting two private keys. Usually we should make them random, and I translate them to points, and I will just output both of them. So you see my first key pair is 17 with a public key r and 15 with a public key p. I define a hash function. This hash function is a really poor hash function. It just takes a string, translates it to numbers, and it adds all those up, and it calculates modulo our prime number. I mean, this is a working hash hash function, but it's not the best hash function. We can still see that it somewhat behaves like a hash function. If we execute this code, we see that if we take this message Bitcoin transaction, the hash is actually 16. And if we just change this big T to a small t, our hash changed quite a lot. And later on, we're going to use this message to be signed, which is our kind of like Bitcoin transaction later on, and it has the hash value of 7. Let's go to the signing operation. I have defined a function sign, which takes two arguments, a message and a private key. And as you can see, basically after creating some random value, here I compute the signature. And this is exactly the formula that we had for S before, in particular when you also do the modulo operation. And this is the big R value, the nonce. So let's execute this code. And before I print the signatures and show you what they look like, let me also go for the verification part, because then I can do both in one step. For this, I need two helping functions. The first one is add points. We're adding 2 points, and this really only works because our group was chosen in a very special way. I'm making heavy use of the fact that in this particular group, I know the discrete logarithm, and the core assumption usually is that for our elliptic curve, we don't know the discrete logarithm. And then we can multiply a point by a scalar, which basically means when you look here, it's adding the point to itself as many times as we have the scalar. And then we can use this to verify a signature. Remember that we take S times G, which is just like mapping S to the point space. For the left-hand side of our equation and for the right-hand side of the equation, we have to add some points, which is first the point R. Then we have to add basically our public key multiplied with the hash of the message. So this is a scalar multiplication. The result is a point again. So we can add this point to R. And to verify the signature, we just check if the left-hand side is the same as the right-hand side. So what we see is that for our key A, the signature on the message that we defined looks like 8, E, and this is a true signature. And for our key B, which was a different key, our signature changed a lot. If we, for example, would modify our signature a little bit, let's say that for this signature we add 1 to the S value, then the verification says it's a false signature. And if we change the R value, then also it tells us that this is a false signature. The code, you can find it in my Git repository in the Lightning Network book repository. I will obviously link this in the description. And yes, the Lightning Network book is really going to happen. As most of you know, I was in hospital for quite some time and I'm just returning. In the background, I had some negotiations with some people. So there's going to be, hopefully in late August, a major announcement regarding this book. And yes, since I'm just out of hospital, I'm literally unemployed. So it would be really great if you show some love and you contribute to my fundraiser or become a Patreon, or if you need help and consulting for Lightning and Bitcoin, you could also just contact me. Now, after having these basics, we can go to the music situations where we have multi-signatures and then use those to create adapter signatures and get rid of HTLCs in Lightning. However, after this post-production, I already see that this video is getting so long that I decided to separate this video into several parts. So subscribe to my channel to see part 2 and 3 and maybe even part 4 of this video series. And I am really looking forward to meet you in these later parts and have a conversation about this really cool upcoming signature scheme for Bitcoin.